What up, Whiskey Ginger fans? Welcome back to the show. If it's your first time joining the show, welcome to the show. Please like it, subscribe it, leave a comment down below for the algorithm. Helps us out, push it around YouTube. I appreciate you guys watching these episodes. This week, it's Rick Glassman, a master of words, a genius in taking different turns. I love this dude. I've known him for a long time. This episode is very confusing for those that aren't really paying attention. It goes into deep crevasses of the conversational brain space, and it goes out there, and I'm happy we did it. I'm on tour right now. I'm on tour. I'm in Boston, dude. I'm in Boston at the Wilbur Theater, and we sold out a couple of shows, so I'm happy about that. San Francisco at the end of the month. I'm coming out there to Ghouls and Ghosts in San Francisco. Get your tickets right now at andrewsantino.com. And after that, I go on tour, baby. The Tito Cheeto tour starts setting it off in October. I'm going to Atlanta. I'm going to New York. I'm going to Grand Rapids. I'm going to Pittsburgh. I'm going to Columbus. I'm going to Portland. I'm going to Seattle. Portland and Seattle and Philly, we all added second shows. Philly, Philly, Philly. Come get those second show tickets. The first one's selling out. I'm going to be adding Florida very soon, so stay tuned. But go to andrewsantino.com for tickets. andrewsantino.com for your tickets. Come out and see your boy live. Enough rambling from me. Let's go to the episode.
In here, we pour whiskey, 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 whiskey.
You're that creature in the ginger beard.
Sturdy and ginger.
Like vampires, the ginger gene is a curse.
Gingers are beautiful.
You owe me $5 for the whiskey and $75 for the horse.
Gingers are hell no.
This whiskey is excellent.
Ginger. I like gingers.
Sometimes after doing some weed.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Whiskey Ginger. My guest today is one of my favorite people on earth. I say that for all my guests, but I mean it once again today. It's the return of one of my oldest and dearest friends, not only in comedy, but in life, and a person that I pride myself in knowing due to his talents, his abilities, his skill set level,
lower this
his looks.
Because
I need to finish my intro.
We might do it again.
I need to finish my intro.
I need to be
intro.
Higher up. Am I going to still be in frame?
That's exactly the height you have to be.
It's like you're doing one of those things where you're the pharmacist.
Rick
and
Glassman
you're being higher than
is
me.
Here. He is a good old buddy. I love him to death. He's a Valley boy. Brody would have been proud. He's an 818 kid. He's lived in the Valley since I've known him. He's never moved from the Valley.
Well, from
you moved up in the Valley, but you stayed in the Valley. You moved the place you were at. You moved. Rick Glassman's here. A great comedian, a great actor, a great writer, and dare I say. A philanthropist.
I dare you. Do it.
I'll take truth instead.
Well, how about this? How about since you give so much, it's time that I give back to you. Andrew, you have been such a good, close, personal friend of mine for so long.
Yeah.
But every time we see each other, I keep forgetting to gift you this sweatshirt from when you helped me out back in
Rick.
December of 2015.
Let me see.
It's got your name on it, Andrew.
Andrew. Thank you, Rick.
Andrew was a shining beacon on the hit TV show, The Sixth Lead.
Was not on TV.
It was. It was on Hulu. It was on Hulu.
It was on Hulu?
It was on Hulu for a while.
Wow.
Yeah.
Thank you for this, Rick.
Absolutely.
Really comfortable.
Oh, yeah.
And did you leave?
That's a private gift that you happen to find. But
wow.
Yeah.
Ricky gave me, for those that don't know. Very rare. A Rick and Goblin card. A Take Your Shoes Off card. A Take Your Shoes Off special. This is one of one.
Well, no, I have more of them.
This is one of one.
But that is one of the ones.
So this is one of one, this one.
But listen, that was a private in the sweatshirt. I figured when you put it on, you would find a little gift.
Well, I found it early because I went snooping around. Cheers to Rick. I'm going to have a little bit of Blanton's. You don't want anything, do you?
No, I had a little bit of Kiva's.
You have a little bit of Kiva chocolates.
Yeah. Now, they're not a sponsor, but I always, whenever I talk about it, I treat it like one because it is like, this is something I believe in so much. It's the weed that I always choose.
So check it out. I am not a... We've spoken pretty openly over the years about our sexuality. Mm-hmm. And it has nothing to do with this chocolate.
No.
That being said, I'm gay for this stuff.
Yeah. You do it too?
I love this.
People make fun of me when I call it doing weed. As opposed to taking it.
No, you're doing weed.
I'm doing weed.
This is doing weed.
Yeah. Taking it would be this.
Here.
Oh, thanks for letting me take this.
No problem.
Should I do some?
You should. Then you done weed.
You want to do weed?
Yes, I'd love to do weed.
Well, first, would you take it?
I'll love to take some from you. Thank you for letting me take your weed.
Absolutely.
So these are 100 milligrams.
Yeah. I'm a sensitive boy. I take 5 to get lit, 2.5 to get sit.
Okay, so they're 5 mils per hit.
Yeah. There's 20 pieces of 5s.
Pretty good.
Yeah.
The mint chocolates, by the way. Mint chocolate chip is probably a big that's probably a big seller. Because mint chocolate chip ice cream when we were kids, I think that reflects big on adults.
Here's why I think a mint chocolate chip is a good idea. Mm-hmm. You get your sweetness from it, but that mintiness not only helps settle the stomach mm-hmm. because of what the amino acids, not the amino acids, excuse me, the oils, what is it called? Essential oils of mm-hmm. a mint. But also it leaves a refreshing flavor where you feel like I kind of brush my teeth where you don't keep going back.
Right.
It's like why people will have mints after dinner to suppress their appetite. A mint chocolate chip ice cream kind of gives you that treat with a little bit of suppression.
I love that. And I love suppression.
Oh, yeah.
Feelings, emotions. Rick, I have a real question to ask you.
Do you want to ask it now?
I'll wait to the end.
Okay.
How's everything been going?
What were you going to ask?
How's everything been going?
Good. I mean, what
when
do
does
say?
Your show come out? And I mean that.
Who knows?
Do you really not know still?
They think January.
I'm not throwing you for a condescending loop here.
Good.
Did you watch Autism on the Spectrum or Love on the Spectrum?
Yeah, loved it.
It's a good show.
Yeah.
Who did you, spoiler alert, tune out if you haven't watched it. You finished it, yeah?
Oh my gosh, it was nuts.
So who did you root for that you wanted to end up with together the most?
I was upset. Well, they had to go to Mordor and give the ring
yes.
to get married.
Correct.
And are you sure we could do spoilers?
I already warned them, and so if you don't want to know, then tune out.
At first I was for the orcs because I loved the costumes.
Me too. That was my initial thought.
I'm rewatching it now. Literally, I was watching today. I watched the extended uh-huh. cut of Return of the King.
Correct.
On the Spectrum.
Yes.
And some of the effects don't hold up.
I would say a lot of them don't, unfortunately.
They're still cool.
Fine.
Like, imagine if we made that. That's incredible.
Mm-hmm.
But you start watching caring more for the story than some of the wow factor. And I'm rooting for Michael just to get a wife.
You are?
Yeah. He's cute, man. I love how he built a frame.
Yeah.
And for when he puts his wife in it.
Mm-hmm.
Or when, you know.
Yeah.
I don't know if she wants to put his wife in it.
He does.
Well, that's pretty dangerous.
Well, love is love. And I'm not here to judge.
But love isn't enough.
It's not.
Is it necessary? I think it is.
Yeah, for human life to continue, yeah, probably.
You know, when people rely on other people, whether it's a friend, an intimate partner, an audience, mm-hmm. to make them happy, it's unsustainable because at best, you get a moment of satisfaction. But until you could get it sustainably from yourself and make yourself happy, not only are you going to not be able to get out of relationships what you want, you're not going to be able to give because you're in it for something that just isn't possible. Find a way to make yourself happy and then be happy beside another.
And if you can't,
join them.
That's exactly right. I was rooting for Matthew.
I'm not putting him in teams.
I like how concerned he was about how much he felt something when he goes, "This is really nice." I loved when he was in love with an emotion. He was like eating it almost.
I found that maybe he learned what the face is. And it now became a tool of his.
This is a real question I have because I spoke to someone about this. This idea of love that they're looking for, do you think it's fabricated by society and then so then they may not recognize it when it's there?
No, because here's something that you don't need to learn. This is an absolute truth,
yeah.
Not just with human nature, but at least life of mammals. Mm. We seek connection.
Totally.
Okay. Definitely humans, because I really don't know all the mammals. I know a lot of the mammals.
Almost every single one of them I know, except for a horn-nosed sloth.
Sloths aren't mammals. They're marsupials.
I know. I was going to say.
Okay. But how come you didn't?
Because I wasn't finished. You cut me off.
A sloth to a mammal is similar to a peanut to a nut, because a marsupial is like the legume.
Legume.
Isn't that a trail in
Ho Chi Minh?
Yeah, Laguma.
Laguna is the beach here we have.
That's a, right.
I think it's one and the same, if I'm being honest with you. Anyway, I want everyone to find love, regardless of what spectrum you're on.
But here's what I'm getting at. Finding love, the language of it, makes it seem as if it's a treasure, which it is, but not necessarily a buried or missing one to be sought and found.
Yeah.
Love, and as corny as this is going to sound, starts and finishes within self. Okay? Yeah. Now, for those of you who are fans of The Fresh Prince, you may remember the lesson that Will Smith learned, that it's the dragon within, not without. And he goes, without what? And we laugh.
We chuckle.
But dragons aren't mammals. So when we have love for ourselves, it's easier to accept that we're not getting what we think we want from somebody else. And it's also easier to find that we may be getting different things. Experiences, connections, you know, independence.
Mm-hmm.
So if we could love and ourselves, I think that we already found love and everything else. Well, hey, that's just icing.
How come you're spending $800 a month on a rental car?
It's funny that you bring that up. I can't find, the car that I want isn't available yet. And since I'm going in and out of town so often, if I sign a lease of something that I don't love, I'll be paying for months of which I'm not using it. So instead, I pay extra for a monthly rental because then I could take months off.
Mm-hmm.
Taking months off.
Because you're going back to London.
London, Cleveland, my arms are tired. You never know. Yeah.
How much more tired do you think your arms are when you go to London than Cleveland?
Almost double. I mean, it's transatlantic. Are you allowed to say that? How does it, just Atlantic?
Please be careful.
Yeah, Atlantic.
I don't want to offend that community.
Sure. It's an Atlantic trip as opposed to
we call it Global Atlantic Trip now, I believe.
GAT.
Yep.
Gotta get that gat.
Gotta get and get over there.
Gotta get that gat.
Get over there.
Gotta get that gat.
And get over there.
Gotta get that. Gotta get that. Gotta get that get. Yo, I was 17 when the Gat Cat come on the slap pat. How you do a root, baby, root, but Miss Pat. She's a funny comedian. Although, here's something actually I want to ask you.
Yeah.
Some women want to be called comedians because they don't want to be differentiated between men and women.
Comedian.
Some want to be called a comedian.
Yeah.
Kind of like an actor versus an actress.
Mm-hmm.
Where do you stand on that? Not that it's for us, because we could never know what it's like to be an actor or an actress.
Correct.
But where do you stand on categorizing actor, actress, comedian, comedian?
I break it all down, and you're called a comic.
How's that breaking it down?
The male and the masculine and feminine of it all, gone.
What do you think about referring to us as a comic X?
Comics?
Like Latinx, the way that...
Yeah, comics. There's a club called Comics. I think that's what they were doing. They're a little ahead of the game.
Mm.
Comics.
Comics.
Because they want to incorporate everyone. Male, female, non-binary, genderless, gender-free.
Transatlantic.
Diet gender, transatlantic.
Transpacific.
Transpacific, trans-inquisitive, gender light, gender plus, gender fluid, gender hard, gender thick, gender solid, gender soft.
Speaking of hard, thick, soft, or the other ones, it reminds me of a time when I was so confused. I'm a back sleeper.
I know it.
And I like a firm mattress.
Mm-hmm.
And I was having a hard time figuring out what exactly it is that's best for me. I went to helixsleep.com/Tyso, and I found the perfect mattress for me. And if you use promo code Tyso, you get up to $200 off all mattress orders and two free pillows. We'll put up the lower third. Yeah, geez.
We're not going to run that ad.
You're really not going to put that in?
Nope.
Okay. Next time you come on my podcast, I'm going to...
I don't ever run ads on your podcast.
That's fine. You didn't let me finish my sentence.
And I also don't run ads mid-show.
If you take that out, might as well not air the entire thing.
Fine.
Fine.
Then I won't.
Fine. Well, then the rest of the podcast, we could talk about stuff that I know is not going to come out because this isn't happening.
Then start it off.
So I'm going to tell you something that's in private. Sometimes my girlfriend complains about the size of my penis because it hurts her. Don't air this.
She's bummed.
Well, it hurts her even more when she's bummed.
Is that a backdoor bumble thing? I've met your girlfriend, and I would never disrespect her on this show.
How is she being?
But I would disrespect her on your show.
Are we on the show?
We're live.
Are you airing this?
All of it.
That's helixsleep.com/Tyso.
No.
My dad helps me with my ads. Mm-hmm. When I went home to Cleveland, my arms are tired. I did ads with my family.
Yeah.
My dad is so good at it. He's so good at it.
Does he get stoned when he does it?
He's stoned. He's every day. That's not
hyperbole. Your dad is never not stoned.
He wakes up, he smokes, and he smokes throughout the day. He calls it maintenance. So he's not always like, whoa, man, where's the Funyuns, guys?
Who's that guy?
That's a stoner. That's a classic surfer stoner.
You got it.
He does get stoned, but he's always a little bit...
Coherent?
He has always done weed.
How long has he been retired?
He's not retired. And if you actually want to check him out, you could check out Marshall Rug Gallery.
What
we'll
is that?
We'll be right back with a word for Marshall Rug Gallery.
If you're looking for just the right flooring, you need choices. And at Marshall Carpet One, you'll find rugs and luxury vinyl. So make the right choice and visit Marshall Carpet One and Rug Gallery. And we promise, with more than 50 years as a family-owned business, we've got you covered!
I know, look, I'm a sponsor of family businesses, so I'm big into that.
Yeah.
But I thought he has moved on from there and given the reins to somebody
else. No, he has since, he takes Sundays off now, or most Sundays.
God bless.
And he's not working as much, but he still works 6 days a week. Mm. And he does these commercials with such, I don't know if I could say this, and I even saying that, I don't know if I could say this, could maybe set me up to get in trouble, so bleep this if you need to. Just people complain about stuff. But he does it with such vigor. He does.
Can you say vigor?
I didn't even mean it like that. No, I don't even want to play around like that.
What?
That's not even what I meant. I just don't want to sell my dad as a salesman so people think that my dad is treating them as a client instead of family. Because at Marshall Rugg Gallery, we don't have clients. We have family.
He reads the ads with much vigor.
He's so good at it. Mm. And he's memorized all the call to action. So at his rug store, or when people come over, people that we don't really know, he's telling them all the URLs with the promo codes. He has them memorized. Mm. And two free pillows and doing all that stuff.
But that's sweet.
I really love doing the commercials with him.
And your mom has nothing to do with it.
She does commercials sometimes, and she's the best saleswoman I've ever met. Salesperson X. Mm. But my dad is the one that I'm like, this is like let's do this together. You know, it's kind of like
it's a thing.
Yeah, so every week when I'm home, we do commercials together. And they end up being way longer than a minute because it's almost like a separate podcast, you know?
Who likes me more, your mom or your dad?
I can't answer that. Not on camera.
Try.
My dad probably sees you more because he watches podcasts now. My mom loves you. My dad loves you.
But your mom has a love for me that is... it's more of a guardianship. Like, she would take care of me. If my parents died and I said, Mama Glass, I need to be under your watch, she would.
Yeah, she's a woman. She's very maternal.
What does that have to do with anything?
Women, especially mothers, are generally more maternal than fathers. And they...
Says who?
Whom?
Says whom?
A buddy of mine, Johnny Whom.
I know Johnny Whom.
Yeah. He used to tell me that shit all the time. And you know, sometimes people tell you something and you forget it. Yeah. You never even heard it.
Yeah.
And then... one day you're on a podcast doing weed, and then somebody says something, and you're like, Johnny Hume.
I love that kid.
Do you hear what happened about he got his shoulders switched, and his arms are just fucking weird now.
They're out, right?
Yeah.
Well, because they were dislocated so many times, they figured if you put it in the other bone, it might even itself out.
Well, he hypothesized this because he kept doing emoticons where he would do thumbs up, face, peace, or this sign.
Yeah.
But then it was he was doing it on the wrong side, and he's so, I mean, you know, he's stubborn.
Yeah, he's very.
So he's like, oh, really? Well, my left is on my right, and my right is on my left. So now he's able to do it. At least maybe it was a joke at first, but yeah, he got his arms
just
switched.
Just to prove a point, yeah?
Yeah, and you think my arms are tired.
Speaking of which,
yeah.
When you land in London,
yeah.
First thing that you eat.
Oh, easy.
Betty.
Mm-hmm.
And then what second?
A nice crumpet.
Yeah.
Can you say without saying where in London Betty is?
I don't think I can. I think I'd have to tell you her address or nothing.
Tell me her address.
West Side.
How about this? We'll put her address right here. We're going to put up her address right here in the middle. And I know you're not happy about this, but it's right there.
You're not going to be able to find it. She moves every 3 weeks.
Really?
Yep. Same reason why I change my Wi-Fi every 2 days.
What's your Wi-Fi password now?
I can tell you what my Wi-Fi password is a day and a half ago.
Go.
Capital A, lowercase x, 1415. 3419.
That's it.
Mm-hmm.
I could have cracked that easily.
Yeah.
If I was like living next door to you, you know I could hack right into that.
I wouldn't have made it that if you were living next door to me.
That's true. That makes a fair amount of sense. Do you like your new neighbors, by the way, in your new building that I haven't been to yet?
Mm.
But that you've invited over other people, like Megan Trainor and all these other people that have been on your podcast?
So here, I'm...
I didn't get invited over.
I have... yes,
you know,
have.
During COVID, we took walks.
So I'm in...
But I never got to come inside.
I'm in a position right now, Andrew,
yeah.
Where our play will be inspired by truth, and the truth... Your back's hurting, huh?
It hurts a lot.
Yeah? Is it because you're so used to carrying these podcasts? You could relax now that I'm here.
Thank you. So what it is I'll make the announcement. I found out what I have. So I got an MRI, and I found out what I have. A pars fracture.
Isn't it funny that when you do, when you, I mean, it's obvious, but when you put simple joke structures, anything in, it sounds like a joke.
It's funny.
Yeah. Formulas work, man.
They really do.
And it's fun to use them, and it's fun to break them, much like your back. How are you?
Pars fracture is what I have. 2 for 2.
What does that mean?
So I have a stress fracture. My ortho said it's probably from running. Pressure over the years, clapping, because I clap when I run. So this was causing a lot of pressure.
Is that
pressure.
Like when you do like a burp? Not burp, what are they called? Where you're doing abs and you're doing this, like Arnold Sylvester Stallone?
They're called the Sylvester Stallones. Those are called Stalloning.
Yes.
Yeah, I was clapping while I was running. No, I was hitting the ground so much. 7 to 10 miles, I guess, will do it. And he said, you have a small, tiny fracture on your pars, interarticulitis. And unfortunately here, I want to show you the image. That's what the image looks like. You can actually see.
I see the inflamed disc.
You can
disc.
See it right there. Yeah, the disc is massive and you can see the...
I have a question for you. So. Is it true that they say it doesn't matter how small the fracture is, it's how you use it?
It depends on the nerve, because some of these nerves out here, they would rather have a bigger bulge, but some of these other nerves are comfortable with themselves and they don't need to brag about the bulge.
So what are you going to do? Should we find out after a word?
Yeah, we'll BRB.
In here, we pour whiskey.
Hey, making content isn't always easy for all of us. It's been a challenge, an essential part to keep this business I have growing and going. Sometimes you got to do a little presentation, whether it's internally or externally to your squad. You got to use Canva Pro. They're a design platform that empowers you to create and share stunning content in just a few clicks. Designing with Canva Pro is amazingly fast and fun. Choose from thousands of templates that are easy to customize or start from scratch. You got an itch, you can scratch it, design it on your own. They have endless premium fonts, photos, video, and so much more that adds personality and edge to whatever you're designing. Look, it's very simple to use. They let us toy around with it, and I was very surprised. If you have a small business or if you have a small team that you're working on, like our production crew, designing something together has never been easier. Sharing and editing, commenting in real time. They also let you do social media posting. So that content planner, you'll save time planning, creating, posting social media. You can stream it down to one simple source, which I think is very convenient. So if you're a small business human being and you've got a small click crew, clan, whatever you want to call it, you got to try Canva Pro. It's pretty impressive what they're able to do there to share across many platforms, but create all this content in one space to push out to your team. Design like a pro with Canva Pro. Right now, you can get a free 45-day extended trial when you use my promo code. Just go to canva.me/whiskey to get your free 45-day extended trial. That's canva.me/whiskey. canva.me/whiskey. Hey, everybody like the food, including me. HelloFresh is a lifesaver. I've said this multiple times on this show. I love HelloFresh. I use it all the time. At first, I was like, oh, send me one of those things. We'll see if I use it. I love it because I'm a dumb, and I don't know how to cook. And when I look online, it never really works out. I don't know how to cook stuff. HelloFresh has very simple, easy-to-read ingredients, pre-measured, mouthwatering seasonal recipes delivered right to your door. You can skip trips to the grocery store because that's a nightmare. You can count on HelloFresh to make home cooking easy, fun, and affordable. That's why they are America's number one meal kit. And I do vouch for that because it's phenomenal. Everything I've ever made from them is very good. They offer 50 menu and market items to choose from every single week, from vegetarian meals to calorie smart choices, extra special gourmet if you're a fancy pants. Something for everyone to enjoy with recipes designed and tested by professional chefs, nutritional experts to ensure deliciousness and simplicity. Fall harvest is upon us, my friends. HelloFresh is going to have some fall fun in there for you with pumpkin and cinnamon rolls, Friendsgiving ready sides, as well as fresh, high-quality ingredients that travel from the farm right to your front door. Hey, HelloFresh is over 30% cheaper than shopping at grocery stores. Save yourself some money, some time, some headache. I love it. You got to try it. If you haven't, what's going on? What are you doing? Go to HelloFresh.com/14whiskey and use the code 14whiskey for up to 14 free meals, including free shipping. That's insane. Come on, man. Go to HelloFresh.com/14whiskey. HelloFresh.com/14whiskey. Use that code 14whiskey, 14whiskey for 14 free meals, including free shipping right now. HelloFresh, America's number one meal kit.
Ginger. I like gingers.
What I think I'm going to do, spine decompression therapy.
SDCT?
Mm-hmm. They put you in these machines that literally pull your spine apart so that the fluid can hopefully seep back in between the discs.
Now, how many times do you have to do that?
L5.
Why did you do this? That's an L. It looked like you were doing 7.
L5.
Right.
Who knows how many times I have to do it? I mean, dude, I went to this quack doctor who was like...
Are we doing ads for Aflac now?
Yeah. That's one of our main sponsors. But don't give it away. We're supposed to subliminally put it in the messaging.
Speaking of don't give it away subliminally, it sounds like Sublime's don't give it away, give it away, give it away now.
That wasn't Sublime.
Not anymore.
That's true. I'm going to do spine decompression therapy.
How many times do you have to do it?
He said a dozen.
And then what? You go in, you do it, you wait a week, a month?
No, you keep doing PT in between. I've been doing PT.
Yes.
And I did scraping.
Scraping is when they do this to bring the blood?
Huh?
Scraping is when they do this to bring the blood?
I think.
What's scraping?
I don't know.
Well, how do you know you're doing it?
Well, because they did it.
What did they say? We scraped you? You didn't say what was that?
Yeah.
You just took it.
I took it and went home.
Huh.
I'm not going to question these guys. They're quack. Doctors. There it is.
Yeah.
Hey, scraping. Yeah, it's down. It was in scraping the lumbar, lower lumbars of your back to move the tissue and hopefully...
Break up scar tissue,
bring
blood.
Break up scar tissue, bring blood. Hopefully the blood can heal because blood will have those blood cells that will get in there and heal it all.
You getting massages?
Yeah, you know what's so weird lately?
I mean, yes, but I know that's not what you meant, so go ahead.
There's no massages to be booked. I've been trying to book massages all over this gosh darn city.
You sound so Irish there. Did you recognize that? There's no massages to be booked.
There's no massages to be booked.
Yeah, there's a great place right here.
What?
Well, I know you don't like ads, but should I tell you?
Yeah.
The Now.
No, I go to The Now is booked for like 2 weeks in advance. You got to book it out.
Book it out. Start now.
I know. I would like to, but also my schedule changes so adamantly against my own will.
You need to find time for yourself before anything else.
I know, I'm
like
shooting.
Like we talked about at the beginning. Well,
they gave me the job. I got to do it.
You excited about this job?
Yeah.
Have you talked about what it is on this yet?
I've talked about it on Bad Friends, I think. I just, Kevin Hart, Mark Wahlberg, Regina Hall. What a cool lady.
Mm-hmm. She's a good comics.
She's a great actors. She's amazing. And, very sweet. Everybody on there was really nice. There's some really talented actors on that thing.
Was Mark Wahlberg, did he?
Marky Mark.
Was he in the movie The Doors?
Boogie Nights.
Was he in the movie The Doors, or was that someone else?
Entourage.
That wasn't Mark Wahlberg?
Nope.
Okay.
He's the guy that showed his penis in Boogie Nights.
Yeah.
Entourage was based on him.
Mm-hmm. Entourage was based on his manager.
Entourage was based on him.
His manager.
Entourage was based on him.
Entourage was originally a story about E and the management. If you go back and you watch, yes.
Let me tell you something.
Okay.
Too bad. Because Vinny took it over. We can do the movie.
Do you know why Vinny took it over? Because the audience is so obsessed with star fucking.
Hey.
With actor fucking.
Thank you.
That they didn't appreciate the business.
That's a fact.
And you know what? The problem is we call it show business and we act like it's not the business of show. And ironically, we act it pretty poorly.
I gotta be honest with you. Couldn't be more true. Community theater type of stuff.
Do you want to take some weed? Just take it.
You take some weed.
You take it. Just take it.
I don't want to do it.
You don't have to do it.
Because I'm doing this.
Don't do it.
I'll take it.
Just take it.
They got me taking weed on my own show.
This is good, man. I know your back's hurting a little bit.
I haven't seen you in so long, man.
Yeah.
I missed you.
Thank you.
Our walks were wonderful.
Yeah.
Say you miss me.
I do.
Did.
I still do. It's kind of like when someone is like, I'm an ex-alcoholic. And like, no, you're a recovering alcoholic.
So that, do you think... You think you'll use marijuana for the rest of your life?
I don't use it as much as I want to already.
How much do you want to use it?
I would like to do it every day.
Why can't you?
I can.
So why don't you?
There are pros and cons to our choices, and I have found some cons when doing it too frequently. I stay up later than I want to.
Me too.
I eat in a way that I don't want to.
Me too.
I do get tired on the come down.
Me too.
Now, if it's a time where I'm allowed to, I let myself want to stay up late, and I could, today I'm... Like, here's my treat, like a dessert.
So this is dessert?
Yeah, it's a dessert. And sometimes you eat cake a few days in a row. Sometimes I haven't had cake in a couple weeks,
so
a month.
Now I'm going to eat a lot of cake.
I love cake.
Me too.
You know that saying, you can't have your cake and eat it too?
Sure you can.
Do you know the saying?
No.
There's a saying.
What idiot would say that? It's your cake. Who else is it?
So what I've learned that saying to mean, and it is quite confusing, is you can't have your cake and eat it too. Well, then how can you eat it if you don't have it? What they're saying is you can't keep your cake uneaten and eat it too.
Sure you could.
Well, you can't have it uneaten and eat it.
Yeah, you can.
Just tell me how.
Here's my cake. It's
can
uneaten.
Can I take that weed real quick?
Sure, take some weed. Here's my cake. It's uneaten.
Show it to me.
Right here.
Okay.
Three layer. Vanilla
uneaten.
Chocolate.
Uneaten. None of it's eaten.
None eaten.
Right.
Right? In the fridge.
Yeah.
Boom. What is that?
The fridge was closing.
Oh. A loud fridge. We got to get a new fridge. Babe, we got to get a new fridge.
Yeah, we need to get a lot of new things, fucktard. But right now, the fridge keeps stuff cold. We're fine.
I love you, too.
Yeah, I bet you do.
So I go sleep on the couch at this point.
Right. Well, the doghouse.
No, we don't have a doghouse anymore.
Sometimes I go into West Elm and I say, where are your doghouses? And the guys that show me the couch, I know, they're married. Send me this.
Okay.
Yeah. So I have. I'll go. I have a joke.
I'll go.
Go ahead.
I have a joke that I want you to tell.
Okay.
Go.
I'll do it. I'll tell mine though.
No, I'm telling the. You're telling the joke that I told you to tell.
Fine. I don't love this joke.
Well, it's your joke.
No, my. I'll, you want me to tell your joke or my joke?
I want you to tell yours that I told you to tell.
Okay. Here's the one that I'm going to tell now. I get delivery a lot.
Do some more weed.
And I love DoorDash. And if you guys want to go to DoorDash.com and use promo code TISO to get 15% off, 25% off your orders, $15 or more, and zero delivery fees.
Did it land?
It's still in the air.
You got to bring it down.
But how's this?
Okay, let me say this.
I want to finish this.
Please.
I get something delivered, and then I look through the peephole because it's contactless.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, sometimes I wear glasses. But they will take a picture of it. And I say to them through the door, do you want me to take one with you in it? And sometimes they laugh. Sometimes they go, no, I'm just taking a picture. And I know the ones that laugh, they're married.
Tell me about it. That's a good joke.
Yeah, but that's not like a joke.
That's a good joke.
It's like a, it's an in-life joke. It's a like a, this here's the thing I do. It's not like a, hey, let me tell you this joke. It's, let me tell you about this thing I do.
Mm-hmm.
So what were you going to say?
I was just gonna do a small bit.
Well, could you make it? Could you do that bit, but make it as big as you can?
It's hard to make it as big as it
Pitch
is.
Pitch me the small bit, and let's see if we could workshop making it big.
Two Jewish guys walk into a bar.
I like where this is going.
The bartender says, "Bar's closed, pal."
Uh huh.
And then one Jewish guy says, "There's two of us." Pal was singular.
Right. I got it.
Bartender says, you know which one of yous I was talking to. First Jewish guy turns to the other Jewish guy.
What do you mean,
goes,
yous?
I thought
it was just a pal.
Are you going to jump the...
Sorry.
The first Jewish guy turns to the other Jewish guy, and he goes, what's with this whole yous thing? Bartender says, you know exactly. Yous know exactly what I'm talking about.
The guy who knows it wasn't on him picks up the spoon and goes, aha.
Aha.
Yeah. I don't know how to make that big. That just works.
It was just a good bit.
Yeah.
When was the last time you had a sip?
A while. Whose house is this?
Your mom's house?
This shit is big time!
Rick's house. Do you want to have a sip? Have a little snifter. Have a little baby.
Is this because it's more enjoyable to drink with another person? Is this one of those things? There's no way this glass is clean.
Just cleaned it.
Swear to God.
Swear to God on our friendship.
You just clean it today?
Smell it. Smell it. You'll smell dish soap, if anything.
Did you clean it? Tell me the truth, because if you didn't clean it today, it doesn't mean it's deal off.
Look at me. I cleaned it today.
And you cleaned it with?
Dish soap. What do you clean glasses with?
I didn't mean the soap. I meant the vehicle that the soap, was it fingers? Was it a dirty washcloth?
Hand.
Is this what the one I should have?
Or you know, it's funny. I only wash these by hand, with hand.
It's not that funny, but I could see how there's a premise there.
Check it out. Hand me that glass. See?
My grandma says see all the time as if she told me so when I tell her things like, oh, I just did Andrew's podcast. We had a good time. See? As if, you know.
Maybe she did tell you at some point. You forgot.
All right, man.
Poor little snifter.
This is the one I should have?
Sure. I bet you'd enjoy it. It's quite good.
I did take a wine class. I do know I was a waiter at a very upscale steak restaurant.
So you know you put that cork in your butt. You smell it, put it in your butt while you pour.
If it were mine.
That's tradition.
And also, when you pour, you're supposed to pour a glass of wine from the bunt.
From the butt.
Bunt, it's called.
Butt.
Bunt.
But. I think you're mishearing it. It's the butt of the bottle.
You know what I don't like? And I've said this before. When there's a mistake being done, you mishear, you make a mistake. It's so, to even use the prefix of miss, if it's inherently feminine to make a mistake.
Should be a Mr. Steak.
Mm, now there I would go.
That restaurant is good. Why did they close that down? Mr. Steak on Pico and, what was that? Pico and Western?
Pico and Roberts.
Cheers.
Is that a real place?
Yeah, Mr. Steak.
Sounds like a, it sounds like a carnivore's sketch show.
All right, let's cheers it out.
Okay.
I'm proud to announce that we got another good one, good friend on SNL, my boy Aristotle.
Shout out to Aristotle.
Aristotle.
Aetherius.
No. No.
Atharis.
No.
Not going to work here anymore, that's for sure.
That's for gosh darn sure. It's Aristotle Atari.
Mm.
Atari.
If you're doing it singularly.
No, no, no. It is really, truthfully. Isn't that weird?
Which is his stage name.
When you hear Daryl Hammond. No, his real name is.
His real name is Sucrose.
No.
Okay.
It's not.
His born name is Sikrus, and I actually met him on my podcast. He was my Postmates delivery guy.
I know.
He came over.
I know.
He said he wanted to be an actor.
I know.
And now he's doing this, and it's fucking mental.
Yeah, he killed. You should have seen what he did in his audition. He used your tape, which I don't know if you're cool with that, but he did.
I don't mind. Check out the 100th episode of Take Your Shoes Off. He was my Postmates delivery guy. He came in,
mm-hmm.
and he startled my guest away.
I know,
and he did the whole episode. And now he's a fucking, he's on SNL.
Is that Kristen Bell?
She was the first few minutes. He kind of freaked her out because he climbed the balcony.
Yeah.
Boy, was his arms, you know, fine.
But he's strong.
Very strong.
I want to know how that tastes.
This is, it burns.
Well, not yet. You haven't had it, have you?
Yeah, I had a little bit already. I'm very sensitive to drugs.
Just a little. Oh. Yow. Heavy?
I don't know if I understand that descriptor, but I don't think that's something I would use.
Heavy means it's like hitting you
hard.
Is
that the opposite of smooth?
Mm-hmm.
It is?
Mm-hmm.
Then yes, it doesn't taste smooth, but that's, I don't know what would. Chicken or the egg?
Probably the egg.
Maybe the egg.
I would gonna go with egg.
But I will tell you this. When people say what came first, the chicken or the egg? The egg. 100 out of 100 times. It's impossible.
Mm-hmm.
The egg came first.
How?
Because whatever the first chicken was, came from the egg. Whatever laid it was a pre-mutated version of a chicken. So there's a non-chicken that it evolves from. It's a cloctose, right? And cloctose, 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 it evolves into a bushelwhack. Bushelwhacker, bushelwhack, bushelwhack, bushelwhack. At some point, before the bushelwhack turns into the chicken, there was a mutation.
Yep.
And that bushelwhack laid an egg that was hatched into a mutated bushelwhack that we now know as a... Could you bring it, pass it to me for a second? A chicken. So here, give me the bushel whack. Okay. Ow. So the gloctose it lays an egg or whatever a gloctose lay, and the bushel whack is born. The bushel whacker having sex.
Oh, fuck me. Oh, fuck me. Oh my, I'm gonna come.
Right, that, because that's what they sounded like.
Yeah.
And then cummed. Then
came.
It cummed, had came.
Mm-hmm.
The egg was laid, a bushelwhack egg, like many other bushelwhack eggs. But something was weird. This bushelwhack egg hatched into, that's right, what we now know as
a rooster.
Well, yes. Yes.
As a rooster.
Roosters and chickens are the same thing, but a rooster is confident.
What seat do you sit on in an airplane?
Strict question. I'm flying on an airplane.
You're beating me to the punch, pal.
Yeah, well, you don't box for nothing.
Taxi driver says, take me to 14th
and 3rd
Ave.
The horse's name was Friday.
Fuck. A lantern.
He was standing on an ice cube.
Son of a bitch. Her robe was red.
There was a hole in the barrel.
What the fuck? Don't tell me you know the next word I'm going to say because it's...
I don't. Let me hear.
Cacophony.
Tell me more.
That's the only word I know.
Oh, yes. The mother. You see, the mother was the surgeon.
Nobody's better at those jokes than you.
I don't call them jokes. I call them riddles. And I'll tell you what really grinds my gears. Mm-hmm. When someone says, I got a riddle for you, and they tell me some wordplay shit that's not a riddle. It's like saying, here's a puzzle, and it's just a broken plate. Yeah, you could put things together, but that's not what this is.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I got a riddle for you. What has two legs and meows on Sundays? A cat on Sundays who's missing two legs. Not a riddle. It's just a stupid thing you said. I don't know. Maybe I'm my mother's child. In fact, I know I am.
You've got a drinking problem.
Yeah, and that's I ain't got enough booze. Fill me up, mister. You want to do an improv scene where we get to show off your space work?
No.
Okay.
But I do want to talk about... I do want to talk about you and stand-up comedy. Mm. Are you still doing it?
Andrew, that's a real topic you're bringing up.
Are you still doing it?
I have to answer that. Yes, but I want to answer this.
Where?
I have my,
because I want to see
this
you
will
do
already
it.
Have come out. I have my first show. I've done four shows since the pandemic started. The last one I did was back in June. I did Bobby's show in Ontario.
Are you scared? Were you scared because of the virus?
Yes.
Yeah.
I got my second vaccine shot when I was out of town. And boy, after that shot, did my arm get tired.
The right or the left?
Left.
Yeah, the left. The left doesn't. Or yeah. The right doesn't, but the left it will.
So I've been back in town for only 2 weeks now.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the first 2 weeks where I'm like, okay, I'm ready. And I still want to do outdoor shows first, but whatever. So I decided I want to do comedy, and I haven't been doing it. And I have a audience now that wants to come see me. And I decided to find stuff. I feel like I'm starting over again. Where are the shows? Where do I go? And I just messaged some people that were doing shows. And I have my 2 days ago, I looked for shows. I have three this weekend. First three back.
Great.
I'm excited.
Where?
One is... Glendale, that wine something?
Nope.
You probably don't do any of these shows because these are shows that I feel
but
like...
I would like to know what they are.
And the other two are Flappers.
How is Flappers?
I like Flappers because Flappers feels like a club, but it also feels like a room that like... It just do whatever you want. No, not that other clubs don't necessarily, but it does feel like... The Flappers main room has a vibe of the Comedy Store belly room where it's just like, just you know, it's small, try stuff out, except for the venue isn't small. It's a main stage.
Hmm.
Does that make sense?
How many seats?
I'm going to make this number up, but it's 280.
Oh, it's a good size room.
Yeah.
I don't think I've been there.
I don't know if this statement's still true, but I do remember noticing they got some of the best food of all the LA clubs.
You will eat at the clubs?
Yeah.
I can't.
That makes sense. Maybe I wouldn't anymore now that I'm a little older.
Well, no, I got sick one time and I got, then that's like stuck in my head. I got real sick. I got food poisoning from...
You don't want to say what.
I'm not going to call them out.
Yeah.
But it was a bummer. So from now on, I just don't eat at clubs. I don't even eat at clubs on the road that people are like, you should eat here. I'm like, I can't.
I understand that. When I was doing shows more, I was always doing shows to where like I would get two shows a week. And in order to get more, I just go to places. And a lot of times people would put me up, but you never know. I was always still doing that. So I would go to places and I would just chill and I would get a bite to eat while I was there,
yeah,
and see if I could get up, you know? So I was like, I hadn't eaten. That was kind of the routine. I don't think that would be the case anymore.
You're eating better now.
I've always ate pretty well. But that's what I'm saying. Flappers, like, they had good options.
Good food. What's the go-to order, then?
I don't do meat much anymore, but they had these chicken breast tacos that were just chicken and vegetables.
What changed?
I follow a lot of animal Instagram accounts, and I love them.
Me too.
Meat ooh. Meat ooh.
That's the one. Meat ooh. Yeah.
Yeah.
I can't. I can't stop eating it.
I still eat red meat sometimes. It's delicious. But then you see these things where the cow is laying on the woman and they're just...
What are they doing? They're having sex.
Well, they're making out.
Right. Now it's going to lead to something.
I like it. I do like it.
It's a smooth buzz, right? See, it's a little tiny buzz. Is it helping out with the chocolates?
I only took a little chocolate.
Take a little bit more.
By the time it kicks in, this podcast will probably be over.
Who knows? You won't.
Jonathan Hume?
You
I couldn't
won't.
Remember his first name.
Johnny Hume.
Yeah.
Johnny Hume.
In here, we pour whiskey.
Hey, if you're designing a website right now, whether you are an artist, a creative, you're a producer, a coach, you're a, you know, consultant, a gym, a real estate broker. There's so many different things that you could be in this world. You could be anything you want to be when you get big, but you seriously should be using Squarespace to design your site. I used it. It's so simple, and it's kind of wonderful. Beautiful templates that are very easy to use. They also have powerful e-commerce functionality that lets you sell anything online, whether you're selling merch like we do on this show or whatever else you've got going on. You could be selling literally anything, little toenail clippings, whatever weird stuff you can sell. People will buy it. Soiled underwear, they will buy that stuff. It's pretty impressive. Showcase your work if you're an artist, blogger, publish content, and sell products of all kinds online. Squarespace is the place. Free and secure hosting, built-in search engine optimization, nothing to patch or upgrade ever, and you know they got 24/7 award-winning support. I've talked to you about this before. Use Squarespace. If you don't know, you don't know, and you're missing out. Squarespace is simple, it's beautiful, and they're going to help you make a really nice website. Go to squarespace.com/whiskey for a free trial, and when you're ready to launch, use the offer code WHISKEY to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. One more time, that's squarespace.com/whiskey. squarespace.com/whiskey. Use the offer code WHISKEY to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain.
Ginger. I like gingers.
What is the order, then, that you eat at Flappers?
One, two, three, two, four.
That's the food?
What are you asking me?
What's the order of food that you get when you're there?
I don't know if I will now.
Because of what I said.
Since?
The pandy.
I'll make my food.
Would you get the booster shot?
I'm not going to say no.
Huh?
I'm not looking for it. I don't know, man. And also, respectfully, and we'll talk about it if you want, I just want to acknowledge that I don't want to fucking talk about it anymore.
Yeah.
People are always talking about it.
About what?
Vaccinations, cancel culture, who did it, who killed, shot Mr. Burns.
You know.
Yeah, Maggie. Mm-hmm. And I knew, but I loved the joke when the cop, Wiggum, says, I don't know who did it. Do you?
And points at the audience.
Yes, and then beat, reveal. Oh, I don't, Smithers, I think it was, I don't know. I learned so much about joke structure as a kid from The Simpsons.
Yeah.
Just the showing that you could break the fourth wall, but it's not game over. It's, oh, the audience was wrong. That's not what he was doing.
Yeah.
It's literally the perspective. They're so great at it. And they did, at least that was the first time I saw so much of it. So, yeah. So I got to really thank The Simpsons for...
Matt.
I have a signed...
I don't know how to say his last name.
Atheris.
I thought it was Atheri.
Singularly. Matt Groening. Groening?
I always say Groening.
My first girlfriend.
Shout out.
Her family is friends with him.
Here she is right here.
And they went to some bar mitzvah and they were there and they had him sign like a place card that said like somebody's name, seat, table number 6 or whatever, but the back of it. It is To the Rick, because that was my nickname in high school, because I saw in Boy Meets World an episode where Corey becomes a wrestler and he needs a nickname, and he panicked, and he said, Corey the Corey Matthews. And I thought that was funny, so I made mine Rick the Rick Glassman.
Mm-hmm.
And people loved it. And he signed it, and I still have it, and I think I want to get it framed. It's only this big, but I thought a cool way to get it framed would be like a huge Matt Groening, you know? So it's like this big post thing, but this thing in the middle.
Mm-hmm.
So.
I like it.
Thank you.
Favorite episode of The Simpsons?
I'll tell you the one that is maybe one of the, if not one of the more influential ones, which is a common answer, but it's Stonecutters, and I'll tell you why.
Why?
The joke where Homer can't let Marge and the family know that he's part of this Stonecutters society or, you know, pledging to become, and he has to keep it a secret. And he's been like, before he knew what it was, he's been following Lenny and Carl around to figure out, like, what is going on? He's been, so... he's getting up from the dinner table and Marge is like, Homer, you're not going to go stalk Lenny and Carl again. And quickly he decides instead to divert. He goes, no, I'm going to stalk Lenny and Carl. Oh, and then he realizes, or as he says, you don't.
Can't say that. It's DM'd.
Blew my mind. He's that stupid. But, like, it's a real, it's so absurd, but it's really a thing that he did. Like, he's so bad at this thing. What's the worst version of that? But he delivered it the way you normally would. Like, we were talking earlier, the joke structure and change in variables. He kept the formula, but didn't change anything. And I, as you know my stand-up, you've probably seen it sometimes. I love a joke that the punchline is, there is no turn. I love a joke that...
Straight.
You just go straight because everyone is expecting you to turn.
Give me an example.
Sure. I have a joke that it's a longer joke, but I'll do a shorter version of it. Sure. Yeah. Guy walks into a doctor's office. Doctor says, I have good news and I have bad news. He says, what's the bad news?
The nurse is blind.
First base.
Mm-hmm. Guy walks into a doctor's office.
Guy walks into a doctor's office and the doctor says, I got good news and bad news. And you know, doctors, they're doing their thing, right? They're always like, oh, you know, blah, 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 blah. A couple minutes of you know, punchline, 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 punchline.
This is a CVS.
No. And then at the end.
No?
No.
Oh.
The doctor, he says, well, the bad news is you have strep throat, but the good news is that the insurance will cover it and you'll be fine.
That's good.
There's no punchline.
Mm-hmm.
But you give the audience a little bit of joy because you have all these punchlines in between, but it's on this stage that everyone knows. And why do we have to make another doctor's office joke? Why can't we just tell the truth that in school we learn how to solve Pythagorean's theorem, okay? But we don't learn how to do our taxes. In school, we learn about who built the pyramids, the Jews, but we don't learn how to be a mother or a father. I want to learn, how do I negotiate buying a car? How do you buy a house? I don't need to know Pythagorean's theorems. A squared plus B squared equals, how do I take out a loan? I don't know. Maybe I'm my father's child. I am my father's child.
You sure are, kid.
Thank you for listening to that. That sometimes could be obnoxious. I just think, and I don't like getting political, but I think we spend so much focus on like, how big do my tits look on Instagram?
Mm-hmm.
Or what's my best angle? Or how do I play the thong song on a phone where you go do 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 or whatever? How do I take out a loan? What do I do when I'm 6 years into a relationship and it feels like, oh no, is she the one for me?
Mm-hmm.
How do I make myself happy? I don't know, but let me tell you about Ho Chi Minh's trail, which is relevant and important because without knowing our past, we're doomed to repeat it. I don't know. Maybe you're your mother's child.
Brie or Fontana?
I don't eat cheese.
Jew?
I don't.
Jew?
Yes.
Jew. I didn't say which one you like to eat. Which one's more appealing to watch?
Brie.
Yeah.
Same?
Yeah. Of course it is. Of course it is.
What's the point, man?
Tell me about it.
What's the point? Another episode in the can so these fucking trolls at home could be like, oh, I fucking hated him on that thing, but on this thing, I liked him.
What thing do you think they like you on?
The Sixth Lead.
That was a good show.
They could check out on YouTube.
Hulu.
Yeah, well, Hulu and NBC.
You know, I looked the other day. That's a credit on my IMDb, and I didn't realize you got that.
The Sixth Lead?
Put that into SAG.
Listen, man, it won multiple film festivals.
No, it didn't.
It really did. It absolutely did. There's five episodes that totaled 30 minutes. The whole thing was 30 minutes, and I made it as a 30-minute short film.
What did it win?
It won the Audience Award at the Independent Film Festival, and then there was
the IFF.
Some maybe
that's huge.
It was like a different one. It was like not the
original.
It was like one that was like people like at my level are submitting it.
Because here we go, the Sixth Lead.
Yeah, if you go, I think it's in the facts or something.
I need to look now because the Sixth Lead. I was a tow truck driver, a documentary following the professional day to TV star who doesn't really talk that much. Rick Glassman, writer. Rick Glassman, director.
Damn near killed her.
Three awards. IFS Award winner, 2016 Best Short Film. IFS Award winner, Audience Award. IFS Award winner, Best Short Film. So you won the Best Short Film.
There are two festivals. One of them's not in there. There was another one. I don't remember what it is, but I have like a glass, like a thing, like a trophy, but glass, you know, like they give those away.
Yeah.
Like to like police auction shows. You know, like what I'm talking about? I feel like there are trophies you could have made. And it's this thing that they just made, but I non-ironically have it on my mantle. I'm really like,
That's great.
I've always loved certificates.
Do I
trophies.
Get one? Because I was a part of it.
They just gave me one.
But I'd like to get one if I could.
I could reach out.
Please.
Well, let's ask them. I'm sure they watch
the Independent Filmmaker Showcase. If you're watching, which I'm assuming you are,
figure out a way of getting Andrew.
I'd like my trophy.
Yeah.
I don't have any trophies. I've never had a trophy.
Really?
Never.
Not even as a kid? Weren't you a martial artist?
My father took those away.
because you were getting in too many fights. He didn't want to reward it.
Mm-hmm.
That reminds me of when my father, I used to love swords, and I would choreograph lightsaber fights, and but I threw my He-Man sword at my brother's friend, and you know, because the battery powered at the bottom, and it hit, cracked him in the back of the head, and he had to get stitches. My dad took all my swords away.
All of them?
Yeah. I had to find another way to be sharp, and I decided to do it with my wit.
Come on, see Rick this weekend, all three shows, at Flappers, Flappers, and Flappers.
One is something in Glendale, and then a couple of Flappers. But that...
this will have already come out.
Yeah.
Well... maybe they'll go there anyway.
I don't want people to come see me yet.
Why not?
I've done four shows in 2 years.
The material's not there yet.
Probably. I'm sure it's fine. Mm-hmm. But I don't care if people are there. I just don't want to tell people, hey, come see me tonight.
Right.
You know? Let me do it for a couple weeks.
To get back into it.
Just to remember, like, yeah, you know?
You got any presidential stuff? Like any Bush jokes?
Yeah.
One or two?
I have one Bush joke, but the number two Bush. W.
Give it.
Wait, is W the first or the second one?
W is the second one.
Yeah, I have his.
Give him, let me hear it.
Yeah. Now, it's an impression.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. He goes, wait a minute. You're telling me, Dick? I mean, Dick.
Cheney.
You're telling me, Dick, that you did what in the woods? You're going hunting? You did what? People are, you know. And then there's some stuff about, like, WMD. 40 to get rid of some of the creaking.
Squeaky wheel glitch gets the grease.
But it's now it's so fucking dated.
Yeah.
I might have to do like Obama stuff.
No, that's a little too fresh.
Obama, talk like this. If you want to. If you want to do an Obama president.
You do presidents well. Do Jefferson.
Andrew?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm Andrew. You've known me for
Andrew.
Years. Yeah. Jefferson. Here it is.
It is not what you do for your people. It's what you think you should do for the people.
That's good. Van Buren now.
I don't know Van Buren. Was he a president?
Yeah, dude.
Which president was he?
Coolidge.
One of the. I could do the Stifler's mom. Is that who you're talking about?
Yep.
Is that Coolidge?
Yeah.
Is it Coolidge if I do that?
Yep.
Stifler. I don't know. Impressions are tough, man. I said I haven't done it in a little bit. in my head, I could hear her voice, and I really need to try and do it. How do you do it?
I'm taking the dog, dumbass.
Yeah. I'm taking the dog, dumbass.
Down here. I'm taking the dog, dumbass.
I'm taking the dog, dumbass.
Shh, 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 shh. Yeah, you kicked this out a lot.
Shh.
I'm taking the dog, dumbass.
I'm taking the dog, dumbass.
I like that.
You're really good with voices.
You know,
I've never been. It's a magical.
You know, for the
power.
First time in my career, you'd be proud. I am on a animated show as one of the people.
What are the? I've been proud before this. What's the
no,
show?
No, but I mean, I worked for years on trying to get booked for something.
Is it your show or did you book?
No. It's
so you just went in. They don't know, and they're like, we love him.
Without mentioning names, someone we both mutually know was like, hey, we're doing a show and they like you for this thing. You should really submit.
Can I say, guess what the show is?
Oh, no, it's not out yet.
Does it come out in October?
It does not come out in October.
Okay.
It won't come out till next year.
Because a friend of mine has a show that's coming out in
oh,
October.
Oh, what is
I'll
that?
Plug it. It's called Fairfax.
Oh, I'm on that, yeah.
Are you?
I do a voice on that.
So you're doing cartoons all over the place.
But I do one-offs a lot. But this is the first time I've been like a voice on the show.
And have you been doing it?
Yeah. I'm in my 7th episode.
And?
It's just so fun because it is a lot of, it's a lot of work in the idea that, you know, you've got all these people, like the main creator,
Kevin James.
Yeah. He wants to do just mall stops jokes. I can't do it. But the main creator, he's a great dude. But, they wanted a type of way, and so you want to work with them to get it there. And so then after you do it 3 or 4 times, you hear yourself trying to manipulate the voice. And then you get a little self-conscious.
I understand.
Because you're like, fuck, am I overdoing the
yeah.
way that they...
It's like when you have an acting job and they don't want you to improvise at all.
Mm-hmm.
And like, there's some language that just takes you out of the character. Is
totally.
Is that kind of like what you're saying?
100%.
Yeah, and you want to find that sweet spot of like, doing where you're best, but giving them what they want.
Well, what he does very well is he'll make me do a chameleon exercise where like...
voice a chameleon.
Well, I blend into the booth. Then they can't see me for the next hour, and then I get the fuck out of there. I don't think he does it consciously, but it is the practice of it is very interesting that he'll go, the metal sheets aren't going to be in there. And then I'll just try to repeat
it. You're saying he gives you line reads.
Yeah, but no, because he doesn't want me to sound like him.
And what are you saying? I'm not
he's
following.
He's just giving me, how his brain saw the scene.
Gotcha.
And then I have to take it and go, oh, I know what he's seeing.
He's giving you thoughts.
Yeah. He's not reading my lines. He'll just read what another character is saying, and I'll be like, oh, I guess I understand what he was trying to see. Because, you know, when you read a scene sometimes with animation, I see it a different way, and I'll go, oh, I guess I'm not.
Right.
We did a scene today on a fancy yacht.
Lonely Island.
Yeah. Andy Samberg was there.
Okay.
And anyway, it's just been super fun. I got to tell you, it's the first time in my life that I've thought, I'm happy to have the job because I don't know if I deserve those jobs because you're like, aren't the people that work for years to get voiceover like that?
Don't you do that?
I have,
yeah.
But it's not my specialty.
Well, because you haven't done it enough.
I'm trying, but it's called Royal Crackers. It will be out at some point, just like your show will be out. I really do want to watch your show when it does come out on Amazon.
Yeah.
What is it called?
At the moment, it was called On the Spectrum. Then they changed it to Forget Normal.
I'm
trying to get them to call it. But, oh yeah, they might change the name of it. I don't know.
Who do you know on Fairfax? Are you Teddy? You friends with Teddy or are you friends with Matt?
Matt.
I know Matt. How do you know Matt?
You wrote on Undateable.
Oh, right. Yes, correct.
And these friends, we have a lot of mutual friends.
I do feel bad for Bill Lawrence post-Undateable. He really hasn't picked up much.
Well, he did. He's doing well now. He actually is a producer
struggling on
The Sixth Lead. And then the next thing that he did was Ted Lasso. It's a hit now. The people are loving
it. It's a massive failure.
People like it.
Ted Lasso is a massive failure.
I don't like talking about other
people's
projects.
They have about 6,000 views a week. No one knows about the show except for a couple of guys in the biz.
I don't want to... I love him. I love what he does, and I don't want to speak negatively on
a show.
I like the show.
With no reviews, and nobody knows it's out there.
It won multiple Emmys.
When?
Doesn't matter. Hypothetically.
Yeah. Who's your favorite character?
It's not on that show.
Who is it?
Will Smith.
What character?
It's the Fresh Prince.
Oh, for Fresh, so, okay.
Yeah, I told, yeah, never mind.
Go ahead.
It doesn't matter, because I don't know when I'm putting it out yet, but I had Will on my podcast, and...
Well, let's talk about Will.
So I had Will on the podcast.
With Jada.
No, well, he called her, and we actually have to take it out, and I think we don't have to take it out now.
So he's going to let you leave it in?
So we haven't finished the episode, because we're doing a follow-up thing, because instead of a part two, we want to do it. Where we're filming the back end and then I'm posting them together.
Mm-hmm.
So he obviously wants to look at the edit and he likes this a lot. But I just think based on stuff that I don't want to talk about that you could probably guess and you'd be right. But some of the stuff that was talked about on the phone, this was a little bit ago, has since become public and it's okay to talk about. So I don't think I'll have to edit that stuff out. But no, she wasn't on it.
But he called her.
She called him. And at first didn't know that when he answered, she didn't know that he was on the podcast.
Oh no.
And he said it. And then she said, oh, it's fine. And then later he told me, right.
Take it out. Is that your house? He did it at your house?
No, we did it at, so I met him 2004, 2005 at Kent in Ohio where I went to college. I was bowling. I was at a bowling alley and I had the first, four or five frames in, all strikes, people in the bowl, it's not a league play game, but people in the bowling alley started coming around and like watching, oh, he's gonna get a perfect game. Seven strikes, eight strikes. Will Smith is there. I don't know why at the time. And I'm still not sure because he made jokes about it. But Will Smith is there and sees it. And I get into the 10th frame and I bowl a first strike. I'm two strikes away from a perfect game. And I end up getting an eight and I pick it up. I got a 288. But that's what brought him over and we were talking and whatever. I still don't believe that he remembers me. Years later, I'm at CAA, which I don't think he's at, but I was a meeting for something. And I saw him and, you know, I was nervous, but I'm like, hey, man, I'm from the bowling. And he goes, oh, that's right. And I saw that he was being nice, but also he must be really good at pretending because, yeah, no, then I remember, and he was just, there's some things he was saying. Told him about my podcast. I showed him a clip and he said he'd be down to do it. And then I didn't hear back. And then his people emailed me and I went to, it's not his studio, but a studio that he was doing something at. Mm-hmm. And we recorded it there. And I was going to put it out, and then he had an idea, blah, 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 blah. We're waiting to put it out until we do the second one, which, when the fuck are we going to... Will, get back, or whoever the fuck is getting in touch with me for this, let me know because I want to post this. And people are saying it's not real or you're never going to post it. And it's like, it doesn't. I don't feel like, oh yeah, watch this, but it's a good episode.
Yeah. How long?
Depends on how I cut it down, but it's under an hour. I mean, we were there for a little over an hour. It wasn't like I didn't have time to do everything I wanted to do. But with it's being cut down and snaps and stuff in between, I would believe if I take out everything that he thinks maybe I should, and if I took out everything I wanted to, if I knew we could get more footage, I probably got 35, 40 minutes out of it. But then we do another one, we put it together, I feel like I'd get an hour and a half.
Who's bigger than Will that you could have on your show at this point?
That I could have on my show or that I'd want to?
Want.
I don't want to say bigger than, but I'll tell you who the heavy hitters are that would be, you know, obviously.
Go ahead, call them out.
LeBron.
James?
Mm-hmm. I would love to have Brad Pitt on.
VP.
I have a history of Brad Pitt.
What is it?
Do you know about that? I don't want to talk too much about it because I still haven't talked about it on my podcast, but I did a prank with him, a mutual friend. Do you remember this? Did you ever know about this?
No.
I don't want to say it because I'm waiting to talk about it.
Say it.
I'm not going to. But I ended up doing a prank that I didn't talk to Brad, but there was somebody else. And this was before I booked Undateable, and it was me and my buddy, and we were each getting paid $1,000 cash to do this.
Big money.
I mean, we're paycheck to paycheck. I'm paycheck to paycheck.
Yeah, no, that's big money at the time.
And this prank thing, I'm hiding in the bushes. Yeah, of course, but now I don't know if I would do... It was like sketchy. Is this real? Is it really going to be him? And right. I saw Brad Angelina, and we did this little prank. And my mutual friend had told me years later that Brad still tells that story, and it's one of his favorite stories. So I feel like if I ever run into Brad Pitt, I'd have a way better end than I did with Will, which is I'm the da-da-da, and I don't want to say it yet.
Right. Do you want to?
I really never told you the story.
No.
If I tell you something, will you promise to bleep it?
Sure.
Or should I just tell you when we're done?
You can tell me now. We'll bleep it.
Will you really bleep it?
Yeah.
It was with Andy. And it was, you have to bleep this.
I will.
Both his name.
Yeah, we will. We'll bleep it.
And also, I don't know if I want to talk about it yet because we're not. They said don't tell people, but this was so many years ago. Whatever. It was a prank where. I'll tell you after this, just in case you think I'm joking about the bleep.
Okay. So we won't cut that out.
Yeah, you might want to trim it down for momentum.
We'll leave that part in for something. Yeah, okay. For momentum. Or do you want to tell, you don't have to, but do you want to tell your Harrison Ford story on the show? I don't want to force your hand, but if you want to, you can.
Yeah, I my only hesitancy is I don't think it's that interesting of a story.
Yes, it is.
So Betty, my girlfriend, she's real. She exists. She lives in London.
People have seen her now.
And I went to a taping of Graham Norton, mm-hmm. and Harrison Ford was on with Ryan Gosling. And there was a bit that Gosling was doing, and I don't know if it was planned or not. It seemed like it wasn't, but you guys did a good job with it. You know, the audience members are mic'd up. They figured it out. But something happens with Gosling and reading a text and fan art and something, and then Gosling comes up and does a very casual, cool thing. And while that's happening, Harrison Ford is just like looking around. And I consciously thought, if I'm going to lock eyes with Harrison, and we looked, and I saw Harrison, and I didn't know what to do. And it's from Kingpin. I went, and he went, and then I found out later, because I wanted Graham to get Graham on the podcast, they messaged me, and Harrison was asking them to take it out. It was a whole big thing, and it was my fault for going,
Why was that your fault?
It's not my fault.
No.
Harrison looked at Harrison and
he did it back.
And it was a thing because maybe they were going to cut it out and who gives a shit.
Right.
But, yeah.
But they didn't. They left it in.
No, they took it out.
Oh, they did?
They took it out. And I don't think that Graham was going to necessarily come on my podcast, but radio silence from it before. I got tickets from his people and I'm trying to...
Usually the BBC is pretty open to kind of that kind of chaos.
It was Harrison that didn't want it on.
Oh, because image-wise.
Harrison didn't want it on.
I get that.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
Also, who gives a shit?
Well, maybe he had something to promote and he was with, you know what I mean? Like it was one of those things where, you know, he's with a family movie is coming out.
I know that I don't know, but also Harrison doesn't do family movies. He does like Jack Reacher type of movies.
You think he's never done a family movie?
Look it up. I'll give you music while you're doing it and then.
Please.
Wait, what's the Indiana Jones music? No, that's Jurassic Park.
That's Jurassic Park, yeah. Dude. That's what you asked me to do.
No, Indiana Jones.
Oh, Indiana Jones is Lido. Whoa, whoa, whoa.
Right. Lido. You just do it while you're looking it up.
Secret Life of Pets 2. Told you.
It's not a family movie. That's an animal movie.
That's a family movie if I've ever seen one.
Oh, but you might be right with voices.
Nature is speaking.
Star Wars isn't a family movie.
Sure it
is. Star Wars is an action movie that's fit for the family.
The nieces love it.
Yeah, nieces love, you know, Independence Day. It doesn't mean it's a family
what
movie.
What a film.
Great movie.
What a film. By the way, I do think I do think Indiana Jones is a family movie.
Indiana Jones is a family movie. Indiana Jones is was
I forgot he was an Anchorman.
Harrison Ford was an Anchorman.
Two.
I don't remember.
Anchorman 2.
Yeah, he was in Star Wars and he was an Anchorman.
Yeah, but not the original. It was so much stronger. Pets, Secret Life of Pets 2.
Maybe that's what he was promoting. He could have said that this was just him though cleaning his fingers.
Maybe he was. Maybe that's a Twitch.
Yeah.
How do you know that's not a Twitch?
Yeah, which, by the way, you could follow me on Twitch at Rick Glassman. I don't use Twitch.
You go live all the time.
I don't use it, but I do have an account.
Well, I don't play video games, so I have no business.
Well, I play Magic the Gathering, and now there's this Magic Arena that people kept saying, you should do that. And I like the physical cards, but I might start doing it on there. But I don't. It's just another thing to do, you know?
And it's already taken up too much of your time.
Yeah, but I love Magic.
Do you? Magic or Magic the Gathering?
I love both.
What the fuck?
Here's the weird thing. Here's the chicken and the egg thing. All of a sudden.
Oh, wow. What? Whoa. Where'd you go to school?
Kent. My dad showed me this one, too. What's that? Over there? Oh, hey.
It's just this. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. You know, this is the...
yes, from Inglourious Basterds.
White power symbol.
Oh.
Do you know this? This is actually the white power symbol.
I know that it's also the okie dokie.
Well, I say okay.
I say okie dokie.
But they've called it white power, and I said, that's a stretch to me.
In Inglourious Basterds, when they know the difference between this and this, I wonder if there's anything to do with German... the Nazis saying three a certain way. Or maybe that's just a coincidence.
Three is drei.
You know what else is drei? Is this Rickhaus.
So go ahead and pour some more, baby boy. Drei. Eins, zwei.
That's from Cool Runnings?
Drei, vier, fünf, sechs, sieben, acht, neun, zehn.
I learned eins, Franz, from Cool Runnings when the German team was pushing down.
Oh.
And then he wanted to be just like the German team.
Fuck, I miss John Candy. I learned German when I was a kid.
I could tell. Because you retained
12,
it.
13, 14, 15.
Why'd you learn it?
16. My mother read this thing about... I went to a language school when I was a kid that taught very young kids second languages while they were developing their English.
Smart.
It's supposed to be really good for your brain.
Mm-hmm.
And my mom read that German was... difficult to learn and a challenge.
I think my girlfriend speaks German.
It's really hard. It's harsh and it's a hard language.
Much unlike this Rickhaus brandy.
No, it's not brandy.
No, unrelated. But I was just talking about another person I would have loved to have on the podcast is Brandy.
I loved her. Everything changed after that accident.
Brandy, Backstreet
Boys.
Where's
a braided chain?
Tupac.
Made of fighting silver from the north of Spain.
I discovered them all. The same time at summer camp, Jewish
Brandy,
summer camp.
Brandy, Tupac,
Backstreet
Boys. Those are the three?
Maybe there's other ones, but I remember around that time is when I people were playing their music. When people play Backstreet Boys, and I have been a fan since I've heard them, and I'm still a fan. But at camp, at this Jewish summer camp, people were fucking Tupac, Backstreet Boys, right? I just discovered both of them.
Right.
Loved both of them.
All eyes on me.
What got me into Tupac was I Ain't Mad at Ya and Changes. I loved the piano of them, and I just loved them.
You've heard the original, correct?
Bruce Hornsby.
Yeah.
The way it is.
That's right.
So I come home from camp, and I ask my brother, who drives at the time, probably still does,
beep, beep,
to take me to Best Buy, because I'm going to buy a CD player and two CDs. Tupac's
Backstreet
Greatest
Boys.
Hits and Backstreet Boys.
Yep.
And my brother made fun of me for Backstreet Boys.
Why?
Because back then, people made fun of people
fuck
for liking
him.
Stuff.
How about fuck him?
Yeah, we were young.
No, look at me. Fuck him.
We were young.
I don't give a shit. You don't fucking judge Rick for liking something like that. Fuck you,
listen,
you
know what? Without people judging you, you don't learn how to truly accept, without condition, this is what I am, this is what I like, and this is the way it is. And I thank him for that, because I am who I am because of the surroundings, and I love him. And Matt, you could check out his restaurant, The Greyhound, in Highland
Fuck
Park.
Fuck you, Matt.
And, but he made fun of me for that, and it wasn't like, I know, people make fun of you for liking boy bands. It blew my mind. It would be like somebody making fun of you for liking Tupac. That's not cool back in the late 90s. Mm. Mid to late 90s.
Pretty cool.
And I just, it did, and I just, it stuck with me. I, like, when, because later on when other people make fun of you, like, I also had this awesome back, Britney Spears CD that I got, because I was buying and selling cards on eBay. So I found, I used to buy these CD, these different toys and collectibles from Asia, China or Japan, I don't remember. But it came and it was this Britney Spears thing with all this Asian writing on it. I thought it was so cool. And it was people were making fun of me for that. Mm. And then there was a moment when I realized, oh, people make fun of you for music you like.
Yeah.
And it was like, I thought it was just my brother being mean to me. No, and it was just, it was so weird. Why do people make fun of you? Like, I just figured it out too late.
What do you think was the thing that, what was the music that they made fun of that actually you stopped listening to?
I never stopped listening.
It didn't bother
you?
It's
just enough people had commented on it. It would be like somebody saying, you like milk chocolate? People only like dark chocolate. You'd be like, oh.
Which people do, by the way. People say that.
That's why it was the closest analogy.
People say that. It's very annoying. Of course I like milk chocolate.
Everyone likes milk chocolate if they like dark chocolate. If not, it's because you're bragging. It's like when people say I'm well instead of I'm good.
No.
Relax.
Right. You're good.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're very good, in fact.
And especially when they say I'm well, if they didn't go first. If I say, how are you? They say, well, okay, that's your language. But if you say, how are you? And I say, I'm good, how are you? And you one up by saying, oh, that's cool. I'm actually well. Missed me. You don't shoot too good.
I don't shoot well at all.
First base. Andrew, man, I love you.
I love you dearly. I really am jealous of your travels, by the way, that you have a beautiful girlfriend that lives overseas because you get a chance to go overseas all the time.
Andrew, when I went overseas...
I miss going somewhere. I don't just want to travel the United States. Well, I've got shows, and you know, it's like hard. I'm touring. But like, I miss traveling to a foreign place.
Could we find
out
where you're touring by the beginning of this episode, or no?
If you go back to the beginning. Stop.
We'll wait here. Yep. They're going to go. Go now. We'll be right here. Just whatever this timestamp is, come back. Whatever this moment is now, come back 20 seconds later.
Yeah.
Okay? Here, I'll time it. You go ahead. Do your thing.
Let them go.
All right. If you need to check your phone or anything, you can do it now.
I don't...
I'm going to wait for them to come back.
I put it on mute. I put it on the moon. Do you know the moon?
Talk when we come back.
Why?
Because they're checking. They're coming back 20 seconds later.
Who is?
The people are checking your dates, and they're coming back 20 seconds after we...
Because you told them to check my dates?
Yeah, so they went back, and then now... All right, and now that you're back...
We're back. Thank you for checking out the dates.
Andrew was talking to me about the moon, the Do Not Disturb on the phone.
Do Not Disturb on the phone. Do you use it?
Yeah.
Why?
Do you promise not to tell anybody?
I won't.
You won't promise?
I promise.
You don't have to.
All right, I won't.
I don't care if people know. Heck, I'm saying it on the podcast.
What's the diff?
You could set Do Not Disturb to be... You could allow certain disturbances.
Mm-hmm.
So if you have it on Do Not Disturb, there are some people that when they call, it'll disturb me. I actually don't even think it'll be a disturbance. That's why it's okay. But all the other people, it won't go through.
Oh,
so,
okay.
So basically, because I don't have a landline phone, because I'm not... Pitch me a joke. Pitch me a punchline. I don't have a landline. Pitch me a punchline? No,
just say it and I'll do it for you.
I don't have a landline phone because
I'm not that kind of guy.
But that way, people could still get a hold of me even if they feel like they need to.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
You know when they say that, the doctor said that on the phone. Is this your landline or your cell? And I went...
It's not my landline
because... It's my fax. It's my
fax. Yeah.
Stupid bitch.
You fucking idiot. Hey, man, you know...
I'm so sick of going to fucking doctor's offices.
Because you're back?
I'm so tired of going. I've gone to so many doctors. I'm so tired, dude.
Hey, man, how are you? Because I get it.
I'm good.
I get it.
How are you?
Good. Good.
Did you have back... You had a back injury?
I had shoulder surgery. I had elbow surgery.
But no back injury.
My back, nothing that I need to have worked on. I had triple hernia surgery.
Bap, bap, bap.
That's the girl from, she did a few episodes of Indatable, actually, this last season, season three.
She was on a show called Whitey.
Whitey, I think it was.
NBC.
Yeah, sure. Whatever. Which one of those?
Yeah. But, you know, the back stuff hurts, but I stretch my hammies where I can.
Fuck, it's the worst.
And I don't where I can't. But, yeah, traveling's nice, man.
Are you doing first class to London?
Yeah.
What does it cost now?
It depends. I found a little secret that I'm not going to tell you on here.
But you'll tell me off? After,
because I really think it's a secret, and it's not for everyone.
But whoa.
On how to get a better, cheaper first class.
Is this a long discussion or short?
I could tell it to you. If I had to tell it to you in under 10 seconds, I could. I would like 30.
Let's do it so then, and then they'll blank it out. Ready?
No, I'm not going to. Just
one,
in case you're. I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to do it.
Three, go. That, oh.
At the exact
That
moment.
Makes perfect sense.
And, but it's usually for...
Are you laying down? Are you doing lay down flights?
Yeah.
The lay downs are the best.
You have to when you're flying
it's
there.
The best.
I told Betty yesterday, because now I'm talking about wanting to do shows again and having an audience from my podcast, and there's a decent chance that for the first X shows that I do, I don't know if I'll lose money, but I will not make money. Because, well, maybe, who knows what my rate's going to be. But I'm flying first, and I'm staying in a nice hotel.
Yeah.
I'm not going to...
What's a nice hotel?
A hotel where...
Like a Four Seasons? Or Ritz?
No.
Just like a nice...
Yeah.
Like an Andaz. Like upgraded from... So there's Marriott, Courtyard.
Yeah, an Andaz is still pretty... Yeah, that would be nice.
Oh, you don't like Andaz.
They're nice, but that's even higher than I meant.
Oh, okay. All right. What about just like you saying a good old-fashioned Marriott? Or a Hilton? A Hyatt?
Some of them have good ones, some of them don't. I'll look at reviews.
A Hyatt house.
I like 4 stars. I want 4 stars.
Right.
I want 4 stars.
Of course you do.
Because I get there's this romantic thing of like, listen, man, you got to pay your dues and you go on to the blah, blah, blahs. But we all pay our dues. If we pay our dues, we all might do it differently. I did it my way. I do it with the podcast and the editing and all the sketches and all the stuff I write and all the bullshit that like I feel like I've gotten to the point to where I don't want to slum it. Mm-hmm. I don't want to do that.
You don't deserve it. You don't have to.
I don't want to come back after a weekend and be like, oh, fuck. I want my shows to be a vacation, not a job.
Yeah.
Now, the hour I'm on stage is a job. I understand that. And I have a responsibility. But I want to fucking go. I want to take a bath. I want to wear the robes. I want good room service. I want to watch a cool movie. I want to come back. I want to come back to a room with cold sheets and get in bed after a shower with a nice pillow and just be like, I may not be making any money, but you got to get the hell out of here. Remember Cribs?
Yeah.
They say you don't have to go home, but you have to get the hell out of here.
I
want to be in a Cribs home hotel.
Mm-hmm. I like that.
Yeah. You see, you're doing theaters, and you have built an audience up from stand-up, and you've been doing this for a long time, and I'm very happy for you. That's why I was saying it wasn't just the cartoons. Very, very proud of you. It makes sense for you to do that.
I stay at reasonable hotels.
Fly first.
I do.
Yeah.
But I refuse. My biggest thing, well, I've been touring for 10 years. My biggest thing 5 years in was I won't stop anymore. Because when you fly month after month after month and you were stopping and stopping and stopping,
oof.
That was the one thing that made me depressed.
Yeah.
Genuinely. I'd be sitting in Omaha, and then the flight would be delayed, and then I'd have to... I said, from now on, from that point forward, I said, I'll never stop again. If I can't get there direct, I need to land and then drive there, which I'm fine with.
Because you always rent a car?
Not always, but if it was...
It is nice when you rent a car.
Yeah, if it calls for it, I will, but I refuse to stop. If I can't get to that fucking city by one major airport and then get there...
Here, question for you. L.A. to New York, would you rather a JetBlue Mint pod, first class...
Love JetBlue
with
Mint.
With a stop... in Texas, but both pods, or fly Delta Plus nonstop?
Do I have to change planes?
Nonstop Delta Plus.
No, do I have to change planes on the Mint, on JetBlue? Do I have to change planes?
Well, now you already told me that if you don't have to change planes, you would take that.
No, I didn't say that.
Well, yes, because otherwise...
I'm just asking for the details.
Don't fuck with me, and let me tell you the logic of this conversation. If you would take the layover if you don't have to change planes.
Where am I going? What am I going there for? Where am I going to New York for?
Shows.
I'm going for a weekend of show or a week of the theater.
Sure, whatever you're doing there.
One
show, theater, and it's paying well.
I'll take the pod.
You take the pod and you'd rather stop.
I'll tell you why.
Well, because it's better.
No, because even if I have to, because I refuse to stop, but even if I had to change planes and I had to stop, it's fine because I'm doing the logic of, I'm going to New York anyway. I've lost 3 hours traveling across the country. That day's always shot. I don't give a fuck when you leave. The only way it's not shot is when you leave on the red eye. Even on the red eye, you wake up miserable when you get to New York. So you leave at 7 a.m., you're still kindling an entire day, you know? So it doesn't really matter. That day is always done to me.
I would argue that's the case at any point if you're flying more than 5 hours.
Well, yeah, I mean, but I'm rarely flying more than five.
I was always okay. I always need extra legroom.
Same.
Because
we're big
boys. We're tall. And sometimes it would be so expensive. So I'm still okay with extra legroom if it's ridiculous.
Yeah.
But that trick I told you about,
yeah,
it really is. It's not that crazy of a way to upgrade.
But it works.
It works. Or at least it's worked 2 out of 2 times.
When I was traveling on whatever I could afford when I first started touring.
Harrison?
What I would do.
That was a Harrison Ford joke.
What I would do is I would offer cash to somebody sitting in an exit row if I couldn't get the exit row on those exit row planes.
Right.
I'd go, hey, man, I have $50 with your name on it if you'll give me that seat and you'll trade.
Is that like
me.
A Michael Blaine trick?
Yeah.
How did you know their name?
Because I asked the ticket lady.
Sorry, I had something in my eye. That makes sense.
Yeah. I go, what's that guy's name? Mm-hmm. So I always would swap, so I'd give people cash. That was a trick I learned.
How many times did they accept it?
Almost every single time. Only once did someone say no because they were sitting with their significant other.
Just say who it was.
Margot Robbie.
Okay. She's not switching.
Of course not.
It's cool, though. You were in the middle or you were in the window?
Window.
So it's Brian, Margot. It goes Margot, Brian, you.
Margot, Brian, me.
So Margot's on the aisle.
Correct.
I bet you would have paid $50 to sit in the middle.
Tell me about it.
So you could sit next to Margot.
That's what I understand. And the whole time she was hitting on me. Right in front of her lover.
It would have to be. It would be, he's in between.
And I'm thinking, this is inappropriate.
Did you do your Margot crazy joke?
I know, don't go Margot crazy on me mid-flight. She spit her drink right all over the place. She did a spit take. It was hilarious.
Dude,
I waited till she took a sip before I said, don't go Margot crazy on that drink.
We are comedians, and there are tools and devices we use, but we're suckers for it. We like to see somebody laugh so hard they spit out their drink.
Tell me about it.
Well, when you were hitting on Margot Robbie, it was worth it for you to wait because then it's like, it also is kind of like you probably got competitive with Brian, her significant other.
We call him B-Boy.
Uh-huh. And then when she's like, he probably made her spit out a drink, but was he able to?
No.
What joke did he try to have her spit out a drink that didn't make her spit it out? Yeah.
Yeah. He goes, what came first, chicken or the egg?
And she goes, what is it?
Do the accent again?
She's Australian?
Correct.
Oi, what is it?
And he goes, obviously the egg, 100 times out of 100.
But he didn't do it as good as me?
Not even close.
Did he do it as well as me?
He did.
And therein lies the rub.
Rick Glassman is going to be going on tour soon. If you do want to go see him, you ought to go watch him.
First time doing this. <It's> so nervous. If you want to go see him, you really ought to...
You ought to go watch him.
He's funny... It's so funny.
I can't promote you.
Sure. Well, we already promoted Helix and Marshall.
Everything about you is promotional. I can't promote you.
Well, don't worry about it.
It's been a long time, my friend, and I love you. And I want to say thank you.
Do it.
For being my friend.
Do it.
And
Do it.
Thank you for being a friend. Let him better back again.
Heart rings true. You're a pal and a confidant. Well, here's my part right here now. And if you...
Look in that camera. Say one word or one phrase to end the episode, as you know. When you're ready, that camera.
Make yourself happy, because otherwise, you'll lose.
In here, we pour whiskey, 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 whiskey.
You were that creature in the ginger beard.
Sturdy and ginger.
Like vampires, the ginger gene is a curse.
Gingers are beautiful.